Good evening, everyone. Greetings on behalf of Railway Academy. I would like to welcome everyone to the third session on TPWS. Our last session was on 3rd of July, and this is in continuation of the last session that we are organizing a masterclass on TPWS from design perspective. Today's session will be focused on design aspect of TPWS. Today we have two very eminent guest experts with us, Mr. Arun Saxena, sir, and Mr. Lalit Mansukhani. So I would like to welcome both of our experts in this masterclass. And without delaying any further, I would like to invite Mr. Lalit Mansukhani to start the session. Welcome, sir.
Thank you very much, Sumit. Let me start the presentation. Good evening, everybody. And our topic will be evolution of train protection and train control system on Indian Railways. Already we have seen previous lectures. Arun Saxena sir's presentation we have seen very nicely. It was explained. And now the focus will be in my presentation will be on indigenous development of train control system, that is train collision avoidance system. So what was the background and all? Actually, here if the initially we had one system by KRCL, Concord Railway, that was known as ACD or anti-collision device. Actually, it has some issues and it was not exactly like standard train control system. And am I audible now?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Absolutely.
So I would continue. So ACD didn't have any provision for prevention of SPAD. Speed restriction control also were not possible to be supervised. It was not movement authority based system. No target speed, no target distance type of thing. No odometry. It was not fail safe system. And the various entity carry out random transmission.
Sir, it's not audible, sir.
Yes. Lalit, sir, your voice is not audible.
Internet issues at my end. Actually, just let me tell you, I have joined at new place and I am at temporary accommodation place. Am I audible?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Please continue.
Since I have joined at new place, so it is temporary type of accommodation. And being Saturday, I am not able to go to office also. So connectivity is really poor at this end, my end. So as I was telling that. There was one product from KRCL, that is anti-collision device or ACD, and it was having limited features, no SPAD prevention, no speed restriction control, no movement authority based, no odometry, and it was not a fail-safe system. So, but since that was the only option available at that time for indigenous development, so Railway would ask RDSO to develop ACDs under new name, that is TCAS, Train Collision Avoidance System. So that was direction was given by Railway Board, and RDSO was asked to develop multiple vendors. So the basic requirement for multiple vendors is the interoperability, and for interoperability we need to have packet structure, etc., open packet structure, etc. But actually, since interoperability was to be maintained with ACD also, so the TKS was supposed to follow ACD packet structures, but those could not be available. And in due course of time, you know, RDSO kept asking KRCL to provide packet structure, etc. So that went from 2008 up to August 2011. And actually, then TKS was confined to 20-page document around, and it could not be brought to field, and because of you know, lack of all those details and all. So then, as I mentioned, that this is just repetition what I have told. So after August 2011, by August 2011, TKS had undergone TKS specification. That document has undergone number of changes, and it came up to version 2.4. But it was aimed to be another ACD with a new name, that is train collision avoidance system. But what happened after that, RDSO decided to go ahead with development of TKS as train control system. Actually, RDSO decided to develop a train control system since there was no hope to get interoperability related information from KRCL. But actually, the project was sanctioned in the name of train collision avoidance system. So it was decided that the same estimate, same project will continue, same name of the project will continue. So then it went ahead with the same name. But basically, what I'm trying to say that before September 2011, TKS was something else, and before and after September 2011 onwards, TKS was actually envisaged as train control system. Train control system having radio communication based system means it could provide continuous update of movement authority. That was one big feature. And of course, it was going to have all the standard features of train control system, like speed prevention, speed control supervision, etc. Let me show you some photographs of ACD. ACD was very intelligent system, but the only thing that it was not aimed to be signaling based system. And so speed prevention, etc., those features are not there. This is ACD installation in a loco. This is the ACD equipment. Previous photo was in driver's cab, and this is what this photo is for inside the machine room of the locomotive. It has got auto braking unit, etc. And since we have already lost some time, I will quickly go ahead. Basically, ACD was non-signaling based system, but information related to fixed structures was stored. Okay, so information related to fixed structures or site related information was there on the locomotive onboard system. So based upon that, when train is moving, somebody's mic is not mute, na?
Sir, it is spotted.
Sumit, shall I carry on?
Yes, sir. Please carry. Go ahead.
Okay. So what was the arrangement in ACD? Like when train is moving ahead, so it will keep on transmitting its location, track identity, etc., etc., and some other train in vicinity is found to be there and approaching towards this train, then the condition will be detected as head-on collision situation and brakes will be applied. Similarly, rear-end collision situation also is detected and action is taken accordingly, and the location determination was through GPS. As I told, there was no movement authority from track side. Track side had very limited role, and since signaling information was not to be transmitted. So why SPAD prevention is necessary? When other types of accidents are coming down, that signal passing at danger type of accidents are not coming out to that much extent. And the consequence also is very severe. And that because of higher and higher speeds, it becomes very difficult for loco pilots to control the train. These things have been already discussed, but this is just for new participants who have not attended previous lectures. Like here we can see that there are two tracks, upper track and down track. This is the real incident which happened at Gorakhpur Kent. That blue train was to negotiate the turnout. It was to move from upper track to lower track. Since this movement was in progress, signaling did not allow the red train, which is on the left hand side, to cross the signal number 32, because signal number 32 was kept at danger or red. But this train overshot and it collided with the blue train, which was in the mid of transition from upper track to down track, and the resultant photographs you can see. So that is the consequence of SPAD or signal passing at danger. So this SPAD prevention facility was not available in ACD. Actually, one accident also occurred in NF Railway, in which the locomotive was fitted with ACD equipment, but it made the SPAD and went into the block section of single line between Panitola and Chabua station on 26 December 2012. And there the collision took place with closing speed of 80 kmph, and there were injuries of 71 people. This is another incident of collision due to signal passing at danger. Train was moving following the blue path, train A, but train B overshot the signal at red and collided at the junction point. So here it was, RDSO decided that we should go for SIL4 compliant type of train control system, having cap signaling features and all those things like SPAD prevention, etc. So this slide I will skip. I will like to draw your attention to last item. Actually, continuous update type of system needs a radio communication. That we'll see in our animation also. If we do not have continuous update of communication, continuous update of movement authority, then what is the drawback and how does line capacity get affected? So I will just stop sharing my PPT for a while and I will show you the video. Sumit, may kindly confirm whether
yes, sir, it's visible.
Yeah. So let me play it. Actually, let me first explain it. This video will consist of this animation will consist of four parts. And first part will, and it is comparison, mainly first two items will be comparison of non-continuous update type of system and continuous update type of system. What is the difference between non-continuous or intermittent update type of system and this? In intermittent update or non-continuous update type of system, the information related to movement authority, etc., is transferred from track side to onboard by means of Eurobalis provided on the track. So, just 1 minute, kindly.
Hello, sir. Kindly unmute yourself. Yes, sir.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for assistance. So, as I was telling, that signals are giving dynamic information to Eurobalis. Eurobalis already have got fixed information like inter-signal distances, etc. So, like it can calculate movement authority, etc. Like suppose signal is green, then how far the train is allowed to go. If signal is double yellow or attention, then how far the train is allowed to go. So this information is static information like gradient, inter-signal distances, etc. are already stored in the Eurobalis, and dynamic information is conveyed to the Eurobalis by means of cable connections through line side electronic unit or LEU. So signals are also interfaced to the Eurobalis. So now Eurobalis has got both the information, static information or fixed information of fixed nature, as well as dynamic information, whether the signal is red, yellow or green, and according to that, how much distance the train is allowed to travel. But the issue is, like, this update will be done only where the balis is installed. So when the train is moving, train will enter from left hand side in our animation. So once the balis is crossed, the information will be updated only at next balis, that is in the upper portion. Now the bottom portion, bottom half of this presentation, the analogous situation, how the movement authority is passed. In this case, bottom portion, it is through radio communication, continuous radio communication. It will be periodically updating the information related to movement authority, etc. Now I am playing the animation. Here you can see the train is entering, and there are two situations. One is upper one is intermittent update type of system, and the lower half is continuous update. So after passing signal number one, it is approaching signal number two, which indicates that this is first cautionary signal, and it is indicating that the signal number four is at danger. So brakes are required to be applied once it crosses signal number two. So either the driver would apply the brake. If driver somehow fails to apply the brake, then the brakes will be applied automatically by the onboard system. So here onboard has picked up the information that the signal next to next is at red, but braking needs to be applied, commenced between signal number 2 and 3. So here, this is the braking curve which has appeared red color, and the train is to reach. Now after passing signal number 3, still the train knows that the signal number 4 is still red, and after that, after passing of signal number 3, the next update in upper half will be only when it touches next balis, that is in vicinity of signal number 4. Whereas in case of bottom half, it is continuous update. So as soon as there is some change, it will be conveyed to the train. Now you can see there is one level crossing gate ahead of signal number 4. And signal number 4 was red because this level crossing gate was open at that time. Now suppose this level crossing gate is closed, and the conditions for signal number 4 to go to other than red are fulfilled, then what happens? Kindly see one level crossing gate which is situated near signal number 5. I think you must be able to locate in the top right portion. So in this particular case, gate is not closed, but suppose gate is closing, then signal number 4 will change to green aspect. Because of this design limitation, because signal number 4 can still be at red or could be at green, so it is necessary for train to allow to touch to the balis installed at the foot of the signal, or of course infill balis I have omitted for our discussion for the time being. So train is required to come up to the foot of the signal number 4. So it means despite knowing that signal number 4 could be at red, train is required to come over here. So top half, if you see, because it is necessary to know the aspect of the signal number 4. Here we can see, since the signal number 4 is still red, so now the train will come to know that it is still red, not green. So emergency brake will be applied and train will be stopped in the overlap portion. In case of intermittent update type of system such as ETCS level 1, we can appreciate better in this particular animation, another animation. Here you can see signal number 4 will turn to green. Now after passing signal number 3, trains are still moving. Unlike previous case, here the level crossing gate subsequently closes. In this situation, you can kindly see I have paused the animation. Signal number 4 has become green. Driver also has seen, but machine is yet to know, because in intermittent update, because machine is yet to touch the next bellies in order to know this. So to be on safer side, continuous brake application will continue, and this is undue braking, because machine still thinks that the signal number 4 is still red. So this leads to loss of line capacity due to this undue braking in intermittent update type of system. So here you can see, in continuous update, then and there the train could come to know, and because it became green through radio communication, here after touching this ballast, it came to know that it is now no more red, it has become green. So now it can pick up the speed and leave. So I will, for the time being, I will just again stop sharing this animation, and now I will I think here I can continue with our presentation.
Sir, visible.
Yeah, yes. So now, as I told that it was going to be based upon radio communication due to the need of continuous update. Kakodkar committee of February 2012 also has given recommendations after consultation with us, we people in RDSO, that the Indian Railway should have system which is equivalent to ETCS level 2. And reason also they had mentioned, because ETCS level 1 being intermittent update type of system leads to reduction in line capacity. So now in 2012, we may consider the situation ETCS level 2, which was already functional, going to be functional and already developed, that was using GSMR or 2G in 2012. But for Indian Railways to commence the development with 2G was not proper, was not prudent, because 2G was getting obsolete. We have stopped getting the parts and all. In fact, new installations were not taking place. And by the time we carry out development in 3-4 years, it was definitely going to get obsolete. So it was not prudent to develop with the 2G. Now coming to 4G. 4G was not available at that time. So there was no option to use 2G or 4G. Waiting for 4G means delay of couple of years in the commencement of development itself. So what we did, like this, I came up with one idea of one communication scheme based upon TDM, TDMA, FDM, FDMA, including direct onboard to onboard communication and multiple paths and priority emergency messages. Were there, and this was fully utilized, frame structure. So this innovative communication scheme helped us, and it was used as substitute of 2G or 4G in development of train collision avoidance system. So train indigenous development communication backbone is this communication scheme, and this communication scheme we had to do had to go for it because there was no other option available at that time. Second item was, you know, what to do with the Eurobalis. I will skip this particular slide. This is for the simplicity. I have shown TDMA. Here I have in this particular slide, instead of multiple frequencies, I have shown only one frequency. Here we can appreciate, like, you know, let me first finish communication part only. And I will tell you about TDMA. We have to make information exchange between track side and onboard. So we can appreciate that different track side equipment or stations, which are adjacent to each other, they should not interfere each other and data should not get mutilated. So what we should do, the frame, communication frame should be divided into time slots. And depending upon the size of the station, the information to be transmitted by station, we can allot time slots to the each stations or stationary TCAS unit. And we can reuse the time slot after, let us say, 100 or 100 kilometer or so. We can reuse because overreach will not cause problem at that particular place. So there is, it is very simple for stationary unit. But what to do with mobile unit, that is onboard unit? Because we cannot allot fixed time slot to a locomotive or onboard unit. It will keep moving in the section from one place to another place. So like number of locomotives are there, then it will be very difficult to manage the time slots. We cannot go for random random transmission. So what we did in this TDMA, that like each station, a stationary TCAS unit will be controlling number of time slots. So once the locomotive reaches in vicinity of a station, and it will continue to transmit its identity, etc., location, identity, etc., in the common slots. Let me put in simple words, in common slot or access control slots. So once the stationary TCAS unit picks up that slot, then it will allot one fixed time slot other than access control slots, which are governed by that particular station. How that station will come to know? Through the location of the locomotive, station will come to know that this particular locomotive is coming to my zone, and it will allot that one of the time slots which are free. So in further communication with that station throughout the session, locomotive will continue to transmit in that particular slot only. So thereby the interference among transmission by various locomotives could be avoided. So once it is avoided, means we can utilize a full time frame, and lot of locomotives we can do with one full duplex communication of two channels of 25 K0 F2D, 16 K0 F2D, that is 25 kilohertz each channel into two. So within 50 kilohertz channel with each pair, we can handle 50 trains which can stand at one place but without interfering each other. That is what is in this particular time frame. It has been designed in such a manner. So one frequency pair can handle 50 trains. So multiple, when the train traffic density is more, like Mumbai suburban, etc., we can go for multiple multiple frequency channels, which is shown here. So it is combination of TDMA and FDMA also, multiple frequencies also. Since it is a bit complicated, so I went for explanation of TDMA alone. So this is what, how TDMA was evolved. This was briefed to the EOI agencies at RDSO, and this is Kakodkar committee recommendations. We have already discussed, so I will skip here. This is like, first we designed the TDMA, FDMA, and then TDMA was demonstrated in lab because we have to convince higher officials of railway in order to first, like, you know, in order to lend to the field on locomotive and tower wagon. So this was the way we demonstrated this thing, this incidentally, this communication time frame scheme was briefed in one of the UIC global seminar in 2013 also. So incidentally, I had photograph of that, so I thought of putting in this particular presentation. Am I audible, Sumit?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Absolutely.
Okay, let me go ahead. So then we, in 2012 April, we started field trial of components, component level field trials. So that was RFID tag, RFID technology, reader, and radio modems. We thought of going for raw radio or transparent radio instead of GSMR and LTE type of thing, in which requires BTS, E-Node B, and all those structures. So we went for this. So that section, initial trials were conducted in Lucknow Kanpur section. This is Amosi station, which is the airport of Lucknow. So it had already had one tower. So that is why we chose this particular station. So after conducting trials in Lucknow Kanpur section, we were a bit confident that we can use radio and tag. So we moved on to some such section in which, you know, we can get like our this particular field trial was. Please don't disturb. Come inside. So this is what this trial was in association with our partner HBL, Hyderabad Battery Limited of Hyderabad. Since all the engineers were at Hyderabad, their engineers, so we shifted ourselves to Hyderabad instead of conducting trials in Lucknow Kanpur section. MOU was made, and this was part of field concept trial. So in this particular trial, you can see here, we measured a lot of things. We made some packets to study, you know, how onboard to onboard communication we can handle, and all packet error rate, etc. We made the studies and all. This is received a signal strength at that time, and we made some test jigs also. Apart from RFID and radio, we carried out the testing of GPS components also. Then we, after this encouraging results, we developed logics for train control, like SPAD prevention, etc. And then we demonstrated this to a high level committee, that is additional member signal of railway board, and director general RDSO, and other people, that is in a lab of one of the company, that is HBL, as I told, in Hyderabad. So after this demonstration at radio communication RF level in lab, we were allowed to commence our trials on cover wagon. So this was the setup in the lab. So these are the photographs of this thing. This system was going to be movement authority based system. So finally, after tower wagon, we switched over to locomotive, and then we started covering all these type of scenarios to display movement authority signal aspect, SPAD prevention, etc. All the train control type of things, in addition to ACD type of features like head-on collision prevention, rear-end collision prevention, etc. Actually, Railway Board had allowed us to conduct this trial of SPAD prevention, etc. But with certain stipulations, like there was one project, OBDSA, or onboard display of signal, onboard display of signal aspect. So Railway Board has given mandate that the signal aspect should be displayed. Although it is movement authority based system, and braking is determined on the basis of movement authority, target speed, and target distance, but signal aspect is simply displayed. It can be switched off at any time without affecting any control or braking. So it can be switched off from locomotive itself by setting one of the configuration parameter, or it can be switched off from station by sending one particular bit in the packet. That is what about this OBDSA. And moreover, we were supposed to retain the non-signaling based head-on collision prevention and rear-end collision prevention logics also, actually features also. So we implemented these features, but these features were implemented in different manner in TCAS, because TCAS was communication was in very much a structured manner, because lot of data was to be transferred and random communication would not have helped here. So that is what. So these are the photographs. Actually, field concept trial, naturally we cannot overwrite develop SIL4 hardware or software. So we made the field concept trials only with non-SIL4 equipment. So here we can see here bottom right, if you see, this is the display on locomotive loco equipment driver machine interface panel. It is giving movement authority also, MA equal to 2743. So that was the system based upon movement authority. Braking was going to be applied on the basis of movement authority, which means it was a train control system. So let me skip this slide. Yeah. So after a successful field trial, Arun Saxena sir also were helped. He provided immense guidance and contributed a lot to this field trial. I must thank to sir. So after successful demonstration, this demonstration was first had by none other than Chairman Railway Board. He was accompanied with the member electrical also. So after having all these scenarios, having watched all these scenarios, he was very much thrilled actually, because 1 year back he was expecting. And he was rather expecting something like ACD, but which was not coming out. And after 1 year of that, in 2011 they were still thinking of something like ACD, but in 2012 October we could demonstrate all train control features type of thing, signaling based system. So we were asked to develop carry on development with multiple vendors. That was very much required also, because otherwise monopoly would have happened. It is distributed system. Partly the system is on track side, and another partly is on board. And there is the open protocol has to be there, so that loco from one make is able to seamlessly function in the section which is having track side equipment of other OEM. So that is called as interoperability. If we do not commence development with more than one firm, then that particular one firm, when the system is developed, it may lead to monopoly. So monopoly is not required. So that's why we started development with three firms. Initial section was taken, as you can see here, 250 kilometer section from Wadi, excluding Bidar and Lingampally. Vikarabad is junction in between. That is absolute block system. But eventually, since it was continuous update type of system, so there was no problem in automatic signaling to make it suitable for automatic signaling also. So we extended our section up to Sanat Nagar, Lingampally, Hafizpet, Sanat Nagar, these two block sections. And incidentally, I am now posted back at this place. So Lingampally, Hafizpet, Sanat Nagar is auto signaling territory, and like all three firms were involved in this particular section. You can see different colors are assigned to different track side of different OEMs. But auto signaling section, if you see, these three stations were there. Lingampally was eventually by HBL equipment, and Hafizpet, that is middle station, is by track side from Karnex, and Sanat Nagar we had track side from Medha. So this equipment were installed in 2015, and demonstration successful demonstration was made in 2015 itself to Railway Board people also. Inspection notes are available. The only thing that at that time we did not have optical fiber cable connectivity to RIU are the locations of the auto signals. Actually, we need to fetch real time information of signals and track circuits and transfer them to adjacent stations in order to make it suitable to auto signaling. So at the time, that function was made on existing spare pairs of quad cables. Few people may not be fully conversant with the railway, working on non-railway. People may be there in today's meeting. So for those participants, let me tell you, actually, quad cable is copper cable, and which is dropped or which has got terminations in block sections also. But optical fiber cable normally was laid throughout from Hafizpet to Lingampally, and in between, it did not have any connection dropped. So that time it was performed on quad cable. It was functioned successfully. It kept functioning successfully for more than 1 year. And that coming back to 2013 and all, that of course auto signaling was done in 2015 for the first time. So these are certain considerations. Actually, for example, let me tell you about tower height. Actually, we were to commence the development immediately without waiting for anything. So 40 meter high tower required more number of clearances, whereas 30 meter tower required a lot of clearances, but not as many clearances as 40 meter tower requires. So therefore, we decided to go ahead with the 30 meter tower in R&D project section only, this 250 kilometer, so that if any problem is there, we'll come to know. If the system starts functioning properly in 30 meters, so definitely it will function little bit better only with 40 meter tower, which eventually we mentioned in our specifications also, to go for 40 meter tower. We carried out some trials to screen out those components which were not going to be suitable for 160 and 200 kmph speed. 200 kmph or 160 kmph speed is the transition for semi high speed. So why we went for this speed and how we went, because at that time our tracks were not fit for 160 kmph at that time in 2013. So what we did, like we made trial run in our 100 kmph section only, and we captured the data. See, the required amount of data, if we were able to read for certain type of RFID tags for two times only at 100 kmph, it means it was going to fail at 200 kmph. So we rejected that type of RFID tag technology. Then other type of RFID was possible to be read 8 or 9 times at 100 kmph, means it was going to be working successfully even at 200 kmph. And our decision was right, because when we got track of 160 kmph available on Indian Railways, same tag worked perfectly at 160 kmph also. Okay, so let me come back to further this thing, our development process. See, although 250 kilometer section was to be installed with this equipment, but this development was to take place from scratch. So from scratch means, as we have mentioned in our tender document also, like we were to confine in one particular small section to develop prototype with the SIL4 development was to take place, hardware and software. So that section was chosen as Kurgunta, Navangi, Mantati, Tandur, this area. And likewise, few locomotives, although we were to equip 40 locomotives, but initially we went for 5 locomotives only. So with that limited section and limited locomotives, we conducted a lot of trials and scenarios, and gradually we developed. Like for in the beginning of 2014, we started having, we were almost able to finalize all types of locomotive modes, onboard modes, like what is staff responsible mode, then override mode, on-site mode, train trip, post trip, something similar to ETCS. We were able to do it, and that too with SIL4 architecture. Parallelly, what we did, like in order to save time, we carried that elaborate type testing of hardware also is required. So we made one another team, and for all these three firms, we started doing hardware testings also in parallel. And also in parallel, we went for survey of the whole 250 kilometer area with loco survey to know where the RFID tags are to be placed. Every meter is to be measured. Then survey for towers. Soil bearing capacity needs to be seen, because foundation will be as per that, according to the soil bearing capacity, and site selection in consultation with division. Then South Central Railway also, engineering department of South Central Railway also had some observations. Then RDSO, bridge and structure directed, also clearance was to be taken. So all that in parallel kept going, and main focus was on development of logics, station TKS and loco TKS logics. So this is some initial photo of initial R&D. Initially we used to do even that RF level, because you can appreciate whatever work we do in a lab, but for such type of project we have to do lot of effort at in field, and that too we Indian Railways doesn't have any dedicated path where dedicated for testing, etc. We have to carry out testing along with other operational trains, commercial trains, passenger trains are running, freight trains are running. In between, whenever we get path, we used to test. This is about you know, RF measurements, power output, return loss, VSWR measurement, so and so forth. And so we used to sometimes test in first in road vehicle car. These were the test jigs made at that time. Then it is showing like signal strength of one station at another station. So we carried out elaborate survey. Here, see, you can see this is a result of one of the locomotive run, which is which was used to measure the radio signal strength. Here you can see clearly, you can see that antenna required adjustment. It was giving proper signal strength at one side, but other side it was poor. So antenna was adjusted, and so these runs were useful. This is then here we, as I told that we were to select which particular type of tag to be used, so that in future, this was conducted, and this exercise was conducted in 2013. So in future we should not face problem while running the trains at higher speed. You can see here, this is the diagram. Here we interlaced different type of tags on track. Like you can see, this is up and down line, blue color and black color tags interlaced, means in similar environment, what is the performance, and we can make the comparison. Then whether single tag is preferable or duplicate tag is preferable. So we install single tag in some portion and duplicate tags in other portion. So we reached to conclusion after all this. We carried out lot of samples, and then lot of configuration, and finally we arrived at conclusion that type D tag was supposed to be used. Type C is more popular in the industry, but it is mainly used for you know, conveyor belt applications, etc. And type D was you know, to be used because the results were better with this. And let me tell you, these observations were meeting with theoretical calculations done by us, and by extrapolating we went for type D tags. This is some result, that observation frequencies. And bottom right you can see there is one diagram. Through this diagram we can calculate, like, you know, how much time a tag will be read when the train passes at 100 kmph or at higher speed. So each and every item, like for example, tower was a standard item, but even then we had to go for all the things: tower design, site survey, soil survey, foundation design and the checklists, foundation execution, tower fabrication and erection, proper material should be bought, then all the records to be kept and all. Then we got some assistance from South Central Railway, some personnel, bridge inspector, etc. And then brake interface unit was to be developed. Initially we went ahead with the IRAB or Indian Railway brake system, air brake system, IRAB one type of system. Then we started development with CCB and NOR E70 brakes. NOR bench and Fevley make brake interfaces subsequently. Here some in, just for here you see how the Bellis was tested, because we were given we were asked to eventually develop the system like ETCS level 2 Bellis based system. It should be interoperable with Bellis. So Bellis development also parallelly we started with all these activities. So first Bellis demonstration and interoperability was made in ERISET lab in September 2014. Prior to that some lab tests were made. So this is the outcome of test that interoperability test conducted at ERISET lab. It was Medha Bellis BTM reader and Ansaldo and Siemens Bellis at that time. So that interoperability was carried out. This is the report. The packets were successfully read. I have taken only extract of that. So all these packets we were able to read, programmed in the Bellis, red, yellow, green. Still, then we conduct, then Medha conducted trials in field also. And these are the data captured to Bellis. What I'm trying to say, Indian Railways or RDSO started Bellis development also in parallel. But since Bellis development is quite complicated, certification is very, very complicated. So it was going to take some few years. That is why we went ahead with the commercially off the shelf available solution, that is RFID tag. And RFID tag did not disappoint us. This is just comparison, like when the signal is red, then what will be the the people working in ETCS know the definition of these parameters, etc., etc. So each and every item we kept taking approval of respective authorities. For example, tag was to be installed on track, so approval from PUA directorate was taken. Then during the initial phase of development, we did not have NMS or network monitoring system installed at central place, and our jurisdiction also was very small. So on that locomotive itself, we installed the diagnosis screens, etc. Because at that time the changes in the logic or software were quite frequent at that time. Source code was required to be changed. Of course, everything was done in well controlled manner, the way ISA was to, or independent safety assessor was to see. So everything we used to record, and such diagnosis tools helped us in development. This was done by all three firms. Here we can see this is movement authority, which is getting displayed in real time. So that then dynamically controlled extent of braking. Suppose train is you can see there two photographs are there. In top photo, top right, the train was going to see there are two types of brake. One is full service brake, another is emergency brake. Of course, there are full service also, there are normal service brake also is there. So basically we call service brake or full service brake. The signal was at red, system started applying the brake, but in between it could come to know that the train was going to stop too far beyond the signal. So emergency brake was applied in top right, if you see, and in the middle, if you see, the train was going to stop too early. So in between the brakes were released and train was allowed to move little bit ahead. So that is spread prevention with the dynamically controlled braking. Here testing of scenario was made in which two trains were heading towards each other. One was real locomotive and another was simulated locomotive. We have got video and everything of all these things, because these are required to be shown to independent safety assessor, ISA, because ISA was very reputed. These were the European firms. We did not want to compromise, and they used to come in 3-4 months. This is very common, very easy to understand diagram. Speed is to be reduced from higher speed to lower speed. Lower speed is called as target speed. Train cannot come to lower speed abruptly. So it has to follow a curve or path. So that is permitted speed curve, green. If speed goes little beyond green, the amber color, it enters into overspeed or warning zone. The brake will not be applied, but warning will be given to the loco pilot or train driver. He will immediately try to control the train. If the speed is excessive and it goes to braking zone or red zone, then brake will be applied automatically also. So target distance will keep on reducing. Accordingly, permitted speed at that particular spot also will keep reducing. Now this is the, you can see the how the system was interface. See, this equipment need to know. Station TKS equipment need to know that current status of all signals, etc. So that it can process the information and transfer the relevant information to the onboard or loco units accordingly. So all the information is stored at central place in form of relay room or EI. So from there, it will be tapped and brought to the TKS equipment. Then TKS equipment will convert it to the in radio communication and convert into radio packets, and the information will be transmitted in form of radio packets. You can see antenna also we went for first of all, it is duplex. So there were two antenna, trans receive, and then that two into two standby antenna also. So total four antenna are there. This is the tower. Of course, now we are thinking of replacing this lattice type of tower with, not replacing the existing towers, but in future, with the advent of technology, to go for monopole type of tower, we are actively considering. This is 2 out of 2 architecture, since people in the railway industry know. So this is an architecture of Medha, in which 2 out of 2 and both the units are built on the same 6U card. Here you can see 6C on the VCC card. 6C is getting displayed. So both the units are functioning all right. For those people who are new to railway signaling, actually it is very difficult to make electronics as fail safe. And as I told that safety integrity level requirement was quite high, and unlike electromechanical components, in electronics, we do not know whether the output will get struck to logic level 1 or 0. So there are some techniques to circumvent this particular, to know that electronics has failed, and failed on what side, that we need to know. So basically what is done, apart from those techniques, that 2 channels are made, and both the channels will keep on giving the output. For example, upper channel is giving 2+2=4. Bottom channel also is giving 2+2=4. Since the output is matching 4, so it will be considered that both the channels are in synchronism. So the output is correct. Suppose one of them says 2+2=5. It means there is some problem with some channel. So then 2+2=4 also is not considered as correct by the system, because one channel is saying 2+2=4, another is saying 2+2=5. So system is considered that it has failed, and it will take the action which is prescribed by according to fail safety. It will act on safer side. This is another configuration. This also is 2 out of 2, but both the units are on different cards. And this is a brake interface unit. Here on Indian Railway, we know that when brake is applied, brake pressure or BP will drop. But at the same time, for loco brake, SA9, BC will increase. So there is light engine unit also. It was not there in ETCS level 1. So light engine unit, what it will do, it will build up the BC. Of course, this also design also is done with a lot of considerations. Like for example, BC should not build up beyond 3 kg per centimeter square, etc. because it will have another problems otherwise. This is another unit. Here you can see it is partly 2 out of 3. See VC1, VC2, VC3 on left hand side. If you can read second item, VC1, VC2, VC3. Actually, Vital Computer was 2 out of 3 architecture here. That is HBL configuration. So here, if suppose one system says 2 plus 2 equal to 4, another also says 2 plus 2 equal to 4, and third also says 2 plus 2 equal to 4, then it would be considered as working perfectly all right. Now, based upon other probabilities, if one says A says 2 plus 2 equal to 4, B channel says 2 plus 2 equal to 5, but C again says 2 plus 2 equal to 4. So here operations are not getting affected since A and C are saying the same thing. Of course, other conditions have to meet, then the system will continue to function. And in online mode itself, we can extract the faulty card, that is channel B card, and then so this is the advantage of 2 out of 3 architecture. So since we were asked to cover design related some items, so we thought of covering this item. So here another BIU by another manufacturer. Then how the RFID tag is fixed on the track. It should not result into pilferage. So all the fixing arrangement will be at the bottom of the sleeper. As you can see here, RFID tag is very electronic thing. And it is encapsulated. It is IP68 compliant. And this is the way RFID tag is used on metro railway as marker. Okay, so that is what. This is the way balise is fixed on the track. When some PV work is to be done, balise can be removed. In ETCS level 1, balise need to have cable connections also, because dynamic information is to be transferred from signal through line side electronic unit to the balise. So that is why cable connections will be there. Now you can see so many components will be there on locomotive. Apart from Vital computer, there will be loco pilot operation and control interface panel. Indication panel, operation control and indication panel on in both the loco cabs. It is something similar to DMI, you can say driver machine interface. Then we have got RFID antenna or RFID reader at both the ends to read the RFID tags. Then brake interface unit has to be there so that automatic brake application can be exercised. All the units continuous health monitoring will be there. For example, BIU is there, but whether it is effective or not, continuously it will be checked, because that is a SILFO requirement. That is heartbeat monitoring. It should not so happen that when there is need to apply the brake, and at that time we'll come to know that brake is not getting applied. So there are GSM modules, GPS module, GPS or GNSS module we use for time sync, because our communication is based upon frame based communication. So reference time is required, universal reference, which is to be followed by all locomotives, all stationary TKS unit and all. So, and then once the time reference is obtained, for next 24 hours, it doesn't require any further sync signal from GPS. It can continue with its RTC or local time clock, real time time clock. This is the display of TKS. Actually, at the time we had HDMI display of ETCS level 1 on Indian Railways, but this you can see, like this is much convenient and convenient to loco pilot, the user. Here you can see a signal aspect is not necessary. We can forget for the moment signal aspect, right portion. Then kindly concentrate to middle portion. Here we have got one dial and two vertical bars. The left hand side bar is target bar, target distance bar, and the blue bar on the right hand side is movement authority bar. And at the center we can see there is one dial arc, you know, it has got two colors. Arc is in olive green and dark green color. Okay, actually this is on approach to one speed restriction of 75 kmph. There is 75 kmph speed restriction ahead, so the train is required to reduce the speed. But at this particular moment, the speed at this particular spot, the speed permitted is you can say as the hook of that olive green, you know, that is 87 kmph is permitted, but at present the speed is 95 kmph. Eventually, after 396 meters, as you can see on target distance bar, after around 400 meters, the speed is to be brought down to 75 kmph. Let me once again repeat, the finally after 400 meter, the speed is to be reduced to 75 kmph. Present speed is 95, but in order to achieve that particular speed restriction, it should have been 87 kmph at this spot. So what is to be done? Brake needs to be applied. So you can see that pointer is red and brake is getting applied, and that is what, you know. So this dial is dial, and these two bars, target distance, target speed and moment of 3D bar, are sufficient to convey the driver the information which he is required to run the train at. Signal aspect is actually not required. This is RFID reader. These are the antenna, how they are mounted on the locomotives of single cab the diesel equipment, diesel locomotive. Then these are the radio installed in the machine room of the locomotive. This is a brake interface unit, electronic and pneumatic brake interface unit. And these are some because three pumps were there and different station, loco and other equipment, so there are a lot of photos of the component. Here you can see again, bottom left you see VC1, VC2, VC3. Here you can clearly see there are three cards, so it is 2 out of 3 architecture by HBL. Now let me quickly cover, see, apparently we were doing all those things in field, in, as I told, limited section, 32 kilometer section with 5 locomotives involving all three firms. But here hardware also need to be tested. There are a lot of tests. I will quickly read the list of tests. Requirement is quite stringent. Visual inspection, insulation resistance, high voltage test, card level test, then system level functional test, then environmental and climatic test, then bump test, vibration test, abrasive environment test, salt mist test. Salt mist test means 3 into 7, 21 days, different cycles will be run. Dust test, driving rain test, water immersion test, EMI-EMC. EMI-EMC tests are quite stringent, let me tell you. And if I have got some photos in this presentation, I'll tell you something about that. Then diagnostic tests and likewise, couple of more tests. This is just like, you know, under environmental category, then we have got dry heat, dry test, operation, storage, cold test, variation, temperature variation test, damp heat, then steady state, cyclic, like that. Then EMI, EMC also is very important test, and variation and interruption of voltage supply, over voltage, surges, electrostatic discharge, transient burst, susceptibility, radio interference. Since we tested it very this thing, so that is why the product could be very rugged, let me tell you. And these are the very stringent requirements for testing. Let me skip these slides. This is the way in climate, environment and climatic test was conducted. This is a chamber in which temperature and dampness can be varied. The equipment in functional state is kept inside the chamber, and it is monitored remotely also. Every 1 hour it will give SMS also. So functionally also we can see. These are the salt mist test photos. These are the card level test. See, everything is going parallel. Some test in field we are doing, and some of the tests we are doing in labs. This is driving rain test. Antenna is to be subjected to driving rain. Then water immersion test for RFID tag, because it is to be tested for IP68 compliance. Bottom right, you can see that dust. And Yeah, let me skip some of the slides. And these are the various, you know, during the testing, the system should continue to function in most of the cases. And log also we used to capture, because all these things are required to be shown to independent safety assessor. Otherwise, they will not believe. So that is why it is very much necessary. So it was very, really very hard time to develop prototype equipment. And these are the various tests. Here you can see test jigs were made and how we two round yellow encircled on bottom right side, data 7F off, data 7 on. So how it is behaving, that we have to see. Then in SMS will come whether the system is functional or not. And then you can see, this is the test. Power supply is to be shorted. There are two power supplies. Output is shorted, but system should continue to function on other power supply. You can see here, bottom side, you can see bottom side, left hand side. It is both the indications are there, yellow indication. When it is shorted, that particular supply will go off, but system will continue to function, and relevant indications also will get extinguished. So this is another, you know, tell reliability of power supply. It is much beyond range it was working, and the cutoff was very sharp. As soon as it crosses a limit, it will be very sharp, shutdown will take place. These are the test jigs, some more test, bump test, this, and water immersion test and all. Salt mist test. This is EMI EMC. This particular chamber, a lot of interfering voltages, electromagnetic voltages are generated, the signals are generated with a gradient of 10 volt per meter. So very high interfering signal. And then this is the setup. No one is allowed to remain inside when test is going on, because otherwise he would get a lot of problems, not only headache, but a lot of other problems also, because of such a strong RF signal. You can see the bottom platform is round and it is rotating platform. And this is thermocol table. So equipment is mounted on that, and the system, the whole setup keeps rotating. And that is on the left hand side, you see interfering antenna. So antenna will generate signal, system will come floor system will complete one revolution 360 degree. Then antenna height will be changed. Another round will be made. Likewise, testing will be completed for one particular antenna and its frequency band as specified in satellite standards. Then antenna will be replaced with another interfering antenna for covering another interfering frequency range signal, and all the all the tests will be repeated. Now, this is another, EMI EMC related test. Conduction emission test is very important. That also we carried out. Then EFT or burst immunity test. See, all these requirements are specified in SANILAC standards. If we comply these standards, our system will not get affected by lightning or very harsh environment of the locomotive. Locomotive has got very harsh environment. Lot of EMI, EMC problems are there. So here you can see 7 kilovolt electrostatic discharge test is being made for those equipment which come into the contact of the personnel, like station unit or DMI or this. See, parallelly, as I told, work was in progress in field also. This was a post-trip confirmation, some modes as you might be knowing. And in order to avoid accidental operations, two buttons were required to be pressed. And then sometimes confirmation also was required. This is SR mode. This is different prompts are there. Here you can see signal aspect is not getting displayed because it is at the initial mode. Then if supposed in order to have testing of this system, we have to set all the safety conditions, route setting of route, etc., but keep the signal at red and ask the driver not to apply the brake. Then only this system could be tested, because we have to make driver to commit mistake deliberately. Then train will pass the signal, then train trip will come or not, like that. So those conditions we used to celebrate. test, and if train trip is there, then at that time this test was done at the initial stage when 4G was not there. So that time we used to have messages, where after 4G we started having information in much more convenient form. This is override, then on-site mode, then speed control in on-site mode. This is the way we used to generate the plans. Still we are doing now. Then plan is converted into, after survey, lot of distances also are required in the to be mentioned in the plan. For example, RFID tag, exact location. Then this is a control table. On the basis of plan, control table is developed, and on the basis of this control table, data is prepared. And after preparing the data, it is like as we do in our electronic interlocking, FET testing. What we do, we test the control table, etc. So here also, TKS control table will be tested. Like this is a sequence of RFID tags which will be encountered for a particular route. Now deliberately disturb the sequence of RFID tags. Insert extra tag or remove one tag. During our simulation testing, then what is the response of the system? Like that, we can test. So this is FET setup, and this is the photograph of FET setup. Now you see, radio survey is very much important. So we can sometimes use our loco equipment with different software. With a loco software itself, some of the parameters it keeps measuring. But detailed measurement we can carry out just by replacing another firmware in which we have detailed measurement of radio signal strength, etc. It can be used as doctor train. In fact, I have given this suggestion also. So like in PUA, we have got concept of OMS train and track recording car, TRC car. TRC car is run throughout the Indian Railway, once in a 6 months, once in a year, depending upon different frequencies. And it will keep on measuring the track parameters, and it gives very useful information. Likewise, this doctor train also we can have. Then, as I told, like initially, it was not in the scope of TKS to go for absolute that automatic train signaling section. But since it was the need of the time, so in 2015, dates also are mentioned in the signature. We started in for January 2015 we started this particular mission, and by June we could demonstrate the suitability in auto signaling section also. Here, how did we do auto signaling section? There are additional information which are required to be given to TKS. So we installed extra location box. That location box with without white paint, without aluminium paint, is new location box, and information was tapped from existing location box. Now information is available. Information about the status of auto signals and block station track circuits. This is sent through RIU to adjacent station, and then the adjacent station tower will transmit corresponding movement authority. Continuous communication is required in the block section for this purpose, which by this time we started having experience that is possible. And normally auto signaling sections means stations also will not be too much apart here, and that was possible here. The way we conducted trials, one local train is going ahead and the TKS equipped train is following that. So how the movement authority varies, that we used to see. And this is first demonstration to Railway Board additional member in November 2015. I think prior to that also we have made demonstration to some of the Railway Board officials. And this is the way, see, how do we have more line capacity with auto signaling? Because in absolute block system, we have got two trains, only one train between two stations. If we provide auto signals, so as many auto signaling sections are there, we can provide those many trains in the block section, as we all know. So more number of trains in block sections or line capacity gets enhanced tremendously with auto signaling. But how ETCS level 2 enhances the line capacity further? Here in auto signaling, the separation between the two trains will be limited to distance between the two signals. Broadly, if we say, it will be, which will be of the order of 800 meters or 1 kilometer. but we can see each auto signaling section is further divided into number of track circuits, each of around 300-400 meters. So if we, instead of signals, suppose we start using track circuits, okay, then the separation between the trains can be further reduced, and headway, because of shorter headways, the line capacity can get further enhanced. See, this is the way it is done in ETCS level 2. In level 3 moving block, etc., that is different scheme. But in level 2, train integrity and detection of train, that is done through conventional signaling system only, track circuit, track axle counter, etc. So through level 2, we can enhance line capacity only up to this level, or TKS also, because TKS also is a communication based system, continuous update system. So it also has got the capability to enhance the line capacity, and that we demonstrated in 2015 itself, but on quad cable. Later on, Railway Board asked us to stop this trial because they wanted this trial to be on optical fiber cable. And again, it was repeated in 2018 in optical fiber cable. These are the, how the track circuits were interfaced and all. So this is the way it was to be done, interfacing in ring topology. And by the time we did it, our prototype development also came towards the end. We learned, we acquired a lot of experience of hardware testing, type testing and all, and in field also. So everything synchronized, and we started getting clearance for tower clearances. Took a lot of time, and we started erecting towers also, and by the time we were ready with towers progressively, our system also was ready for proliferation. And initial development 2013, second half, these tenders were awarded, development and tender. 2014 went into whole R&D and all, and parallelly these tests, etc. But from the mid of 2015, we started proliferating it. See, here you can see, from April onwards, April 2015 onwards, that speed of coverage started rising very fast. Here you can see there is one box on the top left side. See, in August 2013, when we started with 32 kilometer for the purpose of development of prototype. Naturally, prototype development will take time. Then in August 2015, it was 60 kilometer coverage. By September 2015, it became 120 kilometer coverage, because parallelly material was getting ready. October 2015, it became 160, and in November 2015, whole 250 kilometer the territory was covered with TKS installation, functioning installation, interoperable installation, along with 15 more kilometer of auto signaling section. So basically, it is more than 250 kilometer auto signaling section. 15, 20, 16, 17 more kilometers. Two block sections are added here. This is because of such rugged testing. The Railway Board also generated had confidence in the system, and we were given asked to start the trials on passenger carrying trains. So from February 2016 onwards, we started. This is a photo of first train which encountered all sections, auto signaling sections of all three forms. Then first from Sanatnagar to Lingampally, then first section, then first section from Lingampally to Chittigada, from HVL, then Chittigada to Sadashivpet Road by Medha, then Marpally to Bidar by Karnex. So that this is the photo, and you can see the second person from right is Mr. Rahul Jadeja, that AHT who took this train, this historical moment, first passenger carrying train on 15th February, and along with him there is a SSE in between, Raghavendra and other people of the firm, etc., agency people. Then Then actually till now we couldn't get the full spectrum like other channels, so that we were not able to implement FDMA. We were having from WPC only two channels we were having by the time. Railway Vodafone was trying hard to get more channels but not able to get, so that is why we could not implement FDMA at the time, although we tested in field also in isolated section, and we made the report also in 2016 itself. All the firms were ready, but FDMA, because of non-availability of a spectrum, Railway Board given in one of the inspection notes in writing to remove this feature and limit to TDMA only, and FDMA was to be done in next phase. So having tested and reviewing the software from software caused some delay, because this particular stage was in conjunction with the radio security protocol. Means we had two versions, one without radio security protocol and FDMA, another version with radio security protocol and FDMA. But what we were supposed to do, radio security protocol was to be retained, but FDMA was to be removed. So software alteration was to be required, because without radio security protocol, SIL4 certification was not possible. So this is just one example. Like it is para number 6.2.7, if you see, there is one formula. This formula see, here we are displaying signal aspect also, like ETCS, and it is of course optional. So train trip should not occur. So very how to have precise detection in the vicinity of a signal, so that as soon as train crosses and there is dynamic situation, information has to be sent to from onboard to track side will respond. So sometimes undue brake or train trip might occur. So how to avoid that? So, and at the same time to maintain safety, so this particular logic was implemented, because we were using RFID tag. RFID tag has got limitation of size of data for that particular speed. If we increase more data, then speed will reduce. The speed up to which we can use the RFID tag, that will reduce. So what I'm trying to say here, because of less number of bits to be used, we were having resolution of the order of 10 meter, whereas Eurobalis we use for 1 centimeter also. So here, that was the limitation. So we had to, this formula was designed by me only. So train trips could be avoided after that. This is one important this thing. Development was demonstration was made to Honorable Prime Minister. Since people had confidence in this system, then only it was chosen for passenger trials as well as demonstration to Honorable Prime Minister. And thanks for watching. But I want to show you before I close, I want to show you something that another portion of our animation which is pending. Sumit, can I take a couple of more minutes? Am I audible, Sumit?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. See,
sir, the screen is not visible.
Let me share the animation. Actually, what I am trying to show you here, this animation, what we have just now discussed, how continuous update type of system can enhance the line capacity achievable through line capacity beyond what can be achieved through automatic signaling. This was first time demonstrated in 2015. Here you can see left-hand side station and right-hand side station. Let us first of all see, this is an absolute block system in which only one train can remain between two stations. Sorry, this is a video of something else. I think, let me first cover this. See, since the I landed here, so let me finish this portion. During transition phase, when we have got some of the trains equipped with TKS equipment, onboard equipment of train this train control, and some of the trains without this onboard equipment, then how to deal this situation during transition period? See, initially we do not have any train with TKS equipment, and eventually we'll have all. But during transition, how to deal? So and at the same time, start using the benefit of TKS also, because in TKS, as I told, more number of trains can follow each other, one after another. So in one block section, there could be more than one train also. If both if the rear train is equipped with TKS, so that signal number you see signal at one, supervision by ATP at signal number one. Okay, that signal is presently shown as red. You see one yellow dot at the top of that yellow box. Kindly pay attention to that. See, here we can see another train is required to be sent. Green train means the train which is equipped with a TKS equipment. Red train means which is unequipped with a TKS train. Earlier train is not equipped, but the rear train is equipped with a TKS equipment, onboard equipment of TKS. So it this train knows the exact location of earlier train. So this train can be allowed, even if one train is already there in the block section, this train can safely be allowed. See, this green train also went inside the block section, whereas the red train has not yet completed. So green trains can follow one after another in the block section. But suppose some red train comes from first station. See here, red train has stopped. Signal is green to enter into the other yard. But other following trains also have stopped because the earlier train has to move on. As red train moves, then green train also one after another move. That is the beauty of this system. And now, see, now you see other red train is ready for departure from left hand side station, but it doesn't have an onboard equipment, so it doesn't know the location of earlier train. Means it doesn't know whether the train has cleared the block section or not on through onboard unit. So it has to rely on track side signal only. So track side signal is nothing but our line stop signal, which acts here as LSS or line stop signals. Since block station is still occupied for this particular train, red indication will be assumed, and this train will not be able to enter into the block section because it doesn't have capability to know the location of earlier train. It doesn't have capability for automatic application of brake, etc., etc., because it is not equipped with the TKS red train. So when the block section is cleared, then only this red train will be allowed to enter into the block section. So here we have seen how during transition period we can have the movement of TKS equipped and TKS unequipped trains at the same time, taking advantage of enhancement of line capacity for TKS equipped trains, which can follow this. So this is mixed mode traffic. And now let me what I wanted to show you. Yeah, let me come to this portion of the animation. Here you can see that top portion is like block section. Here, what I'm going to tell you, the line capacity enhancement beyond what can be achieved through automatic signaling or IBS. So in absolute block signaling, as you can see, first portion, top portion, only one train can remain between two stations. In automatic signaling sections, there are number of signals. Block section has been divided into auto signaling sections. So each signal can control, after ensuring safety of the route ahead, whether the train is allowed to go ahead or not. So here we can have more number of trains in the block section, and line capacity of the section can be enhanced tremendously by auto signaling. But between two signals, there could be one train. But here you can see there are, you know, further between two stations, the portion between two stations is further divided into small track sections, if you see. So if we go for this, yeah, here you can see. So each we can have much finer resolution that will be of the order of track section, of the order of few hundred meters, and that still more it can be accommodated. You can see that blue trains which are there in between two yellow trains. So TKS and ETCS level 2 can further enhance the line capacity. That is what I wanted to show you through these animations. So now I'll stop sharing the animation, and that is what from my side. Now I hand over to Sumit. What way we should do? I have not seen the chat box, whether there are any queries in the chat box, etc.
There are queries in the chat box. So, sir, I would also like to invite Arun, sir, to also join you in actually taking up questions from the participants. So,
Sure.
I will pick up the questions from the chat, and or if you'd like to just take a glance and pick up the questions as per their merit and answer them directly. So welcome, Arun, sir. Arun, sir, are you able to? I can see your microphone unmuted. Arun, sir, kindly unmute your microphone.
Sumit, तुम्हें अनम्यूट करना पड़ेगा सर को.
I have done that. Sir's microphone is unmuted.
तो म्यूट दिखा रहा है?
नहीं, नहीं दिखा रहा है.
अच्छा, ठीक है.
Whether any action is to be taken by me?
Yes, sir. So what I'll do, sir, let me pick up some questions. So so there is a question from Mr. Ankush Bison, who's asking how loco communication is established in case there is a frequency overlap.
Yes, frequency overlap. Actually, that first of all, frequency overlap will not take place because different frequencies have been specified already. Predefined frequencies are there. Normally access control will be made through one control frequency, and apart from control frequency,
Lalit sir, please carry on.
Otherwise, whether any action is required from my side to unmute Arun Saxena, sir?
Sir, I've already done that, sir. I think there is some technical issue going on at his end. I was able to hear some voices also from his end, but not very clearly.
Okay, so let me continue. Actually, first of all, let me tell you, with one frequency pair itself, we are able to deal a number of locomotives with different time slots. Like our 2 second time frame is divided into multiple slots of few tens of milliseconds. And each loco will be transmitting in that particular assigned time slot only. So there will not be interference in the transmissions made by different locomotives. But when train traffic density is very, very high, like for example, Mumbai suburban, then since the time frame is limited 2 seconds, and number of slots also will be too many slots will be assigned to various onboard or locomotive units. So we'll have to go for multiple frequency channels. So here, in order to achieve that, what we have done, we need one frequency pair for one full duplex communication, means two frequency channels. Okay, so we'll go for another frequency channel also. So likewise, we have got eventually, you know, provision of 5 frequency channels. But how those frequency channels will be decided? There is one control frequency, we call it F0 frequency. So all the common or control related, access control related communication is made on this particular channel. So this particular channel can be heard by all the units. And then the when actually what loco is doing, when it is not registered to any of the when it is not in the zone or in vicinity of any of the station, it will keep on transmitting on the control frequency, access control time slots, along with its location and identity. So this will be heard by all nearby stationary units. So when particular stationary unit comes to know that this particular train is approaching to me, okay, then what it will do? It will tell that locomotive in response when it reaches near that you, henceforth you will transmit to this particular time slot and frequency. So after that, locomotive or train will start transmitting in that particular assigned time slot. So it will free up the access control. So for rest of the, you know, duration, let us say 5 or 10 minutes, as long as it is in the zone of that particular stationary TCAS unit, it will transmit in that particular predefined time slot and frequency, which is already known to the station unit. So that is the mechanism. We avoid interference of transmission among various onboard units.
Okay, sir, I'll take up the next question. Hey, what will happen if communication breaks between loco and ground TCAS? Hello? Lalit sir? Hello, yes sir.
क्या ललित सर का नहीं आ रहा है क्या?
ललित सर, kindly add your microphone is not attached, sir. Arun sir, I've unmuted you, sir. You can unmute yourself also, sir. You are a co-host. Arun sir, Lalit sir, please add your microphone. We're not able to hear you.
Hello.
Yes.
Am I audible now?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Perfectly.
Okay.
Right. Thank you, sir. Thank you for joining us, sir. Thank you so much. Sir, so should we take up the questions, sir, which participants have asked?
I think before we take up the questions, I would like to first of all conclude what has been spoken by Mr. Mansukhani. He has very extensively. First of all, I must thank Mr. Lalit Mansukhani for this extensive coverage. And right from the stage of conceiving the idea, and from the age of conceiving the idea to the development of the functional requirement specifications, the system requirement specifications, and the safety related specifications, they have been worked out. Plus the entire life cycle, right from the stage of FRS and SRS to developmental activity, prototype lab testing, and thereafter designing and engineering a concept for a pilot section, that has been extensively defined. And thereafter, he has covered one pilot section of 250 kilometers and 40 locomotives of South Central Railway, which was a milestone in the history of Indian Railways. First Indian railway train control system was showcased. And now the issues which he has flagged, which I think will be of interest to all the participants here. Let me clarify for all the participants that the current strategy and decision is to provide Indian Railway Train Control System, which is called TCAS, to be deployed all over Indian Railways. This is the current policy now. So for to handle this current policy, there are certain requirements. And those requirements, number one is that it should be able to manage train running at 160 kilometers per hour or 200 kilometers per hour. That is important. And in that area, he had mentioned that the trials have been done for because RFID reader is the main issue there. If you are not able to read the RFID at each stage, then the train control system cannot be handled. So that is what they have been able to handle in the initial trials itself. And second one was the requirement of automatic block signaling without signals. He has explained about automatic signaling with signals, but he's also explained how automatic signals without signals can be handled, provided you have installed optimized track sections. So depending on the mixed traffic situation, which we have all over the country. Now this automatic signaling is not there in the entire country. It is there in hardly 3,000 kilometers of Indian Railways. And if you look at only the golden quadrilateral and diagonals, it is almost 12,000 kilometers. So definitely the entire track section of this 12,000 kilometers will have to be provided with track sections using axle counters or audio frequency track circuits or any other track circuit. And that is what is the requirement. I must compliment him. And now we can take up the questions which you feel like. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, sir. I'll start with some of the questions.
I think I can moderate it now. I think Mr. Subir Basu, he has been interacting with me, and he has also very clearly advised me that this is a very, very complex subject, a very, very varied subject. And therefore, we have to have, right from the fundamentals to the stage of installation, commissioning, and maintenance. There are different stages. So I would suggest that Mr. Mansukhani and the subject matter experts who are available with us, we should work out some kind of a tutorial, each tutorial should not last more than 45 minutes to 1 hour, with the frequently asked questions also included in that. So that fundamentals first, then we talk about ETCS. If somebody wants to know about ETCS, we can go into that direction. Or if somebody wants to know about TCAS, then you can go into that direction. So this suggestion from Shri Subir Basu is well accepted, and we can work on that. And that is what I'd like to mention. Anyway, so the first question is coming from Mr. Subir Basu, which is on my chat box, that has the failsafe been certified for the TCAS, which is to be like ETCS level 1, and are the tests being done on goods and passenger trains with CRS sanction? If not, how? Sir, for your information, sir, first of all, TCAS is a superior system to ETCS level 1. ETCS level is a ground-based system, linked through BALIS and LEU, that is the line electronic unit. TCAS can be more equal to ETCS level 3. In fact, I can even say that. It can be even level equal to ETCS level 3, provided we have a method of detecting the train integrity and train location, which is possible. But currently, the TCAS current development is equivalent to ETCS level 2. I would request Lalit Mansukhani to kindly indicate what kind of safety certification has been done by the independent safety assessor, and what kind of trials have been done on passenger and freight traffic. Mr. Mansukhani, please.
Thanks, sir. Actually, that RDSO has issued a panel of reputed independent safety assessors. That panel mostly, like, you know, because of experience and competency, none of Indian agency could get into it, and all were reputed ISA agencies like TUV, ITAL, Certifier, and all. So when we awarded the work to these three developer firms, OEMs, so they were required to choose one of the these reputed agencies from the panel. So HBL and Connex chose Italcert and ITAL Certifier, and Medha chose Atkins. So they were supposed to do, because that was developmental trial, not only the design, but development and life cycle comments also. So as it is done in any standard independent safety assessment, these people used to give their comments right from the inception of design, because as Sir Saxena sir guided, that it is to be throughout life cycle, not only life cycle, but from inception of design itself. So all the things were shared with them by the our OEMs, and after that thorough assessment, they were going through the field trial data and sometimes coming to the field trial section also. So after all this thorough assessment, the safety case was finally approved by the ISA. So thereby we could get the safety assessment done for system also, in a way, because system was interoperable and designed by, you can say, centrally controlled by RDSO, but through these firms, OEMs, we could have ISA. In fact, let me tell you, the team which was team of ITAL Certifier for HBL and Connex were also different. So independence was maintained there. Thank you, sir.
Okay. Now the specific question is that whether you did obtain the CRS sanction for doing the trials on passenger trains. That's a very specific question. Did we go to the CRS for starting the trials on passenger trains on the South Central Railway?
Sir, as far as I know, that CRS sanction has not been taken. And since it was pilot development, like in ETCS also, ETCS installations, initial installations in Agra, Delhi section, and Chennai Gummidipundi section also, CRS sanction, Railway Board has waived the requirement. Here also, CRS sanction was not sought for. But eventually, sir, not only CRS sanction, but change in operating rules also is required, because loco pilot has to follow a lot of procedures. Those are defined right now in manual. Sir, you can kindly throw more light on this, sir. I think you are the proper person to tell about it.
For the benefit of the participants and Shri Basu, we believe that we are not doing away with the driver and the functionality, and therefore it was being added as an additional safety layer. And therefore, the Railway Board issued a directive in the year 2012-13, when we were commissioning ETCS level 1 BALIS based system on the Delhi Agra section, that there is no need of CRS sanction. But I am told that the Southern Railway project did obtain CRS sanction, and they went ahead with that. Anyway, let us move to the next question, because the time is running out. There is a second question coming from Mr. Nagesh Reddy. Nagesh Reddy has a question called, RFID antenna missed the communication, unable to read the data from BALIS. What will happen? How to identify the train is block section or not, if any redundancy and safety is added? Lalit, if the RFID is missing, or the RFID antenna reader is missing.
Yes, sir.
That is a very, yes, sir, very, very, very dangerous fault.
Yes. Actually, at every place we installed two RFID tags, and Loco also has got two RFID readers. just to reduce the probability of missing, but it can still miss. So as it is done in the ETCS also, the balises are linked. Like the previous balise would tell after how much distance next balise will be there. So there is some window. So through that, it can keep tracking whether the balise is missed or not. Similarly, here also, in TKS also, RFID tags are linked to each other in nominal and reverse direction. And through this, we can come to know whether any RFID tag, linked tag is, that we term as normal tag in TKS parlance. So that is missed or not. So this has got very vital information. So we have seen if one tag or two tag are missing, so nothing great is going to hamper. Only thing that accumulated error in the odometry will keep on increasing. So there is permissible limit. So after that permissible limit is crossed and we keep on missing the RFID tags, then first warning will be given to the driver and it will come out of full supervision mode. Driver has to acknowledge TKS supervision is no more available. If driver doesn't acknowledge, then brakes will be applied, sir.
Thank you.
So it is something similar to ETCS.
Okay, thank you. Yes, you have another question from Mr. Reddy. That is, balise interface unit is safety critical equipment or not? I think this is basically part of the locomotive. And I think Mr. Manchukani has also answered it, that ETCS or TKS gives only a command to the BIU when to brake and how to brake. I think I'm correct, Lalit?
Sir, I could not fully follow the query, but yeah. Yes, TKS or ETCS, brake interface is actually outside the ETCS.
That I explained. So now the next question is coming from Mr. Pramod Vani. What is the difference between TPWS and TKS? I think that also has been explained by you in the chat box.
Yes, sir.
I think I can again repeat, even at the cost of repetition, there is the TPWS in the UK perspective is different. All the participants, please. TPWS, that is Train Protection Warning System in the UK, in the British Rail, is different. It is exclusively a single vendor system, but deployed all over British Rail. Indian Railways adopted this name, Train Protection Warning System, for ETCS Level 1. And ETCS Level 1 is a ground-based system, not a radio-based system. It is a ground-based system linked through a balise and LEU to the signal or to the interlocking. And whereas TCAS is basically a radio-based system, but it has got the functionality of anti-collision device as well as the ETCS Level 1 and amalgamated into a common system, which is called Train Collision Avoidance System. So I think we can have separate discussion on this subject. There's another question coming from Shri Subir Basu. How is interoperability achieved with each type of loco having different brake and traction control system as far as electronic and end state interface is concerned? Lalit, for TCAS, how is interoperability achieved with each type of locomotive having different brake and traction control?
This query I couldn't fully follow because actually compatibility at card levels is not envisaged, but interoperability can be achieved, sir, because actually that protocols between RFID tag and RFID reader, those are standard open protocols, as well as the protocols between onboard to track side and track side to onboard. Those also are open protocols, and some certain security features have been incorporated so that as per EN 50159 open communication radio communication, that how to make this open despite being this open protocol radio communication, how to make it secure communication. So that we have already got certification.
Just to add to what Lalit is saying, sir. Just to add to what Mr. Lalit Panchukani has said, I think I had explained one document diagram to you that there are two interfaces which have to be standardized. One is the interface between the RFID and the RFID reader, and the second one is between the radios. If that interface is standardized, then interoperability is feasible because this is the way the system interact with each other. You can have the onboard TCAS equipment on the locomotive of company A interacting with the ground equipment of TCAS of company B. And this is possible only when that the radio protocol is standard, is followed by every company. And the good thing RDSO had done along with the team of the design and development was that they chose three companies. In fact, if you see the pilot section, they have taken three sections one with Medha, one with Carnex, and other one with HBL Knife. All these three companies have sat together and followed the same RFID and the radio interface protocol, so that the system is able to interoperate the way it is explained and the way it is done in ETCS also. Anyway, another question coming in from Mr. Prasanth Yama. I think that also has been answered in the chat box. The train derailment occurred in block section. Loco onboard TCAS unit generates the SOS or not? If it is generated, how to protect the other train movements with the derailed train? I think you've answered it very clearly. There's a question from Rajesh Patel. What is the time required for station preparatory work? I think this is an important question. I think I must thank Rajesh. When you talk about station TCAS equipment, then there is some preparatory work to be done, because the TCAS system takes all inputs from the station interlocking. And there is a long list of functions and statuses which are defined to be interfaced to the TCAS. I would request Lalit what kind of work is required and how much effort is required, because that is a very, very important. And if you make a mistake there, then there can be problem, because verification and validation is very important there. Lalit.
Yes, sir. Actually, regarding current status of TCAS, TCAS has already got SIL4 certification and approval from RDSO for auto signaling section as well as for speeds up to 160 kmph.
My question is that Patel has asked, what is the time required for station preparatory work?
Okay, sir, I'm missing that query. I thought it is current status of TCAS, sir.
No. What is the time required for station preparatory work?
Sorry, sir. What I couldn't listen to you, sir. What is the station?
What is the time required for station preparatory work? What kind of work is required at the station so that you can interface to the station?
Okay, sir. Got it, sir. For TCAS, basically
interface.
Yes, sir. Actually, yeah. Let me tell you, for any train control system, we need to transfer some information to onboard system, which is of the two nature. One is the information of fixed nature, like inter-signal distances, gradient, etc. So that can be programmed in the TCAS stationary equipment or station TCAS equipment. Now, there is another information. What is the current status of signal aspect or the marker? Like how far the train is allowed to go, track circuits, etc. So all the information is available at centralized station interlocking. So that information is tabbed, like relay room or EI. So that information is tabbed from the interlocking, and through fail-safe interface, it is acquired by station TCAS equipment. Now station TCAS equipment has got fixed information as well as dynamic information. Now, depending upon onboard train location, it will transmit the movement authority and other relevant information to the onboard.
Anyway, just to add to what Lalit has said, is that at the station you have to do an additional rack where the wiring has to be brought of the required contacts to the rack, and that rack will be interfaced with the inputs to the TCAS. Whatever functions are defined, whether it is track circuit or point or signal or any route requirement, that will be interfaced there. And that is an effort which is required to be done at all stations and all RIUs also in the block section.
I accept it, like everything is ready from hardware side and a production side, something is ready. So if we take it in a mission mode to say install it sometime 2 year or 1 year time period in a specified 2-3,000 kilometer and some say about 1,000 stations. So if we can replicate that when it's scale up, so what sort of station typically station will take, where our ground equipment to be installed plus parallel some wiring signaling can be done, sort of thing. Those time if we take it, so because manufacturing and getting the material will be also be an issue. So that was
actually each wayside station will require maximum 3 days. Once the rack is erected on the first day, and the list of functions already is given to the contractor or to the manufacturer, or the system integrator that this is what is required to be wired. So as per the wiring diagram, you have to issue a wiring diagram in advance that these are the contacts which are spare contacts to be taken. If there are no spare contacts, you have to develop repeater relays. As for that, in my opinion, for a small four line station, it should not take 3 to 4 days. But the bigger requirement will be from the angle of erecting the tower, that 30 meter tower, that is a time consuming thing. And that doing the survey of radio survey as well as the RFID survey, measuring the distances. These are two very critical requirements which have to be done. I think we can discuss more about it in a specific session on the subject on installation and manufacturing time. But definitely, if your intention is to be work on a mission mode, then a lot of things will have to be, a lot of, I think, segments will have to be standardized.
Whether the radio
segment or the station segment. And your last question about the loco. Loco TCAS installation also has to be, the drawings have to be standardized for different types of locomotives so that we are able to do the work in a time. And once that is done, then it is just going and fit fit and connect kind of a situation. Anyway, we go to the next question. It's coming from Mr. Sheikh Nasser Wali. What is the current status of TCAS? I think I would say that TCAS is currently certified for 110 kmph for Indian Railways. And it has already, I think, gone initial certification for 160 kmph along with the automatic signaling also. And these have to be now, physically checked and certified in the field condition on an extended network. Okay, the next question from Mr. Patel, Rajesh Patel. I think time is running out. We'll take just last two questions are there. Mr. Patel is asking question. Railton is going with partnership with OEMs. How envisage for in coordination with Zonal Railway? I think this question will not be easy for us to answer because Railton and Aircon have their own style of working. And definitely, if the Indian Railways have to commission something like 12,000 kilometers in the next 3 years, then there has to be a very, very conscious effort by the Zonal Railways. I am told that the Delhi Howrah section has already invited tenders by North Central Railway, North East Central Railway, and Eastern Railway for about 1,500 kilometers. And this tender is to be due for opening in the month of August. So this much information is available, but the current projects are being done by the railways. I think Railton and Aircon have currently no toll. But there is a question emerging from this. The current system of TCAS is based on UHF. And it is a thing which we have been living with it and we have been working on it for a long time. But now talks have started coming in that why can't we go in for 4G LTE? On that work has to be done. So I think in the initial phase will not focus on, in my opinion, it will not focus on the LTE interface of TCAS. Currently the phase one will be with the 400 megahertz band in which the system has already been tested and certified. Okay, I think there are no more questions. Thank you everybody. If there are any more questions, I think the person can straight away switch on the mic and raise the question. Thank you all of you. Thank you for joining.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you. Thank you, Arun, sir. Thank you, Lalit, sir. Thank you, Rajesh, sir, and everybody who has taken out their precious time to attend this masterclass. Thank you for making this masterclass a valuable resource, knowledge resource. We will upload the session recording on our YouTube channel for people who could not attend it today. So thank you, everyone. Thank you so much. Have a great evening.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.